some come and be changed.
Good morning. Welcome to Wausau Alliance Church. We're glad that you've joined us for service this morning. If you want to make your way in and find a seat, we're going to get started. This is our second week of Missions Conference, and so we're excited for that, to have that focus again this morning. And there's a couple things with that. We wanted to remind parents who had kids who read the missionary biography, there is going to be the pizza party after second service for those kids that read that. And so you can join us for that. Also wanted to give a reminder for next Sunday evening. There's going to be a fellowship dinner in Burnhamwood. It is not at the church. There's more details if you look at the pre-stream of this service, you can find the details there. You can also talk to Pastor Josh. I think it's called the Matchy Center. I don't know if I'm saying that right. But that's going to be happening next Sunday night. And so we would encourage you to join us for that. I'm looking forward to that, meeting some of the people there. This will be the last one of these before the church launches on April 3rd. And so we'd encourage you to join us for that as well. If you would join us, stand with us as we begin worship. We're going to look at a well-known passage from Philippians chapter 2. Let's read this. So if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. And being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God has highly exalted him and bestowed on him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Let's praise him together.
Hallelujah. join the song they're already singing. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. Just bow down before your throne. See your face, I'll cry out because you're holy. Thank you.
Our prayer this morning that your kingdom would come in our community and in our state and around this country and around the world, Lord. We don't have to look far to see the needs of people for you. Lord, as we look around, it can be so overwhelming, but God, we truly believe that your gospel, your truth is the answer. And I pray that you would impress on each one of our hearts the role that we play in that, whether that's here in this community or somewhere around the world. God, I just want to lift up people of all ages who may be beginning to think more deeply about your calling to maybe pick up and go somewhere and be a part of your mission, Lord, that you would confirm that in those hearts, God, that you would prepare them and give them the skills and the abilities that you want to use in your work, Lord. Pray, God, that we would all be open and willing to follow you wherever you call, Lord. Thank you for the many examples we have just out of this body that have picked up and gone to a variety of places, some very difficult places, Lord. God, we also just pray for our local needs, those who might be sick. Pray for Kathy Iceland, who fell and injured herself yesterday. Lord, I pray that you would raise her up and give her strength and encouragement. Lord, others who can't be with us due to illness or other circumstances, Lord, we pray that you would meet each one of their needs. Lord, today as we give, we just give freely and with an open hand, knowing that it all comes from you. And God, I just pray for open hearts today as we continue to focus on what you're doing around the world. And speak to us, Lord, through your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. And kids, you can stay put for just a minute, and then we'll dismiss you in a little bit for Children's Church.
When I put on my sandals, I must first put on the right foot. When I enter the mosque, I must enter first with the right foot. When washing before prayer, I must wash my right hand, then left hand, then the feet, starting with the right foot. Only after I am completely clean can I pray. And when praying, I must stand foot to foot so that the devil cannot enter through the gaps. 5 times a day I pray and follow these rules because I am a Muslim. I have always been a Muslim. My family, my friends, everyone I know has always been a Muslim. We know of no other way. I live beside the ocean. I am a fisherman. I rise early every morning with a call to prayer and go out on my boat. I love the ocean. It brings me peace and it helps provide for my wives and my children. I return to sell my catch at the market. I bargain for the best price, but there's no bargaining with fate when I catch nothing that day. If Allah wills that I catch nothing, then who am I to question his judgment? And yet, there are even more important questions that I'm not supposed to ask. I hope I'm a good Muslim, for someday I will be judged by Allah. I'm fated to go to heaven or to hell, but I cannot know which. It is a terrible thing not to know if my life of following the rules of Islam will be good enough. I try hard. I say the Shahada. I do the prayers. I give to the poor. I fast. But is it enough to earn Allah's mercy? I cannot know until it is too late. I used to feel peace as I watched the sunset. But now, at the end of the day, as the shadows grow, so does my uncertainty.
Sharing this morning on behalf of Bobby and Sarah Kulp. They're missionaries that our church is sending out to Kenya, who will be working with AIM, who produced that video. Bobby and Sarah were supposed to share this morning, and Sarah woke up really sick, so their family needs to be home this morning. But as that video shared, it's a part of AIM ministry that Bobby and Sarah are really passionate about, where they'll be located in Kenya. Bobby will be serving as a pilot, missionary pilot, with AIM Aviation. And they'll be serving not just Kenya, but many different countries surrounding them. And their heart and what they're really hoping to do is to reach people who are living in darkness in many closed countries, who don't have access to it, where it's not legal to be spreading the name of Jesus. It's their hope to be able to go into those places and to bring the light of Jesus. And it's something they're very excited about and how the Lord will use them as they go. A little bit more about Bobby and Sarah. You can see their picture up there. They've got their two boys. They will be launching about a year from now, and they are in the process right now of finishing some of their training. They've got Bible courses that they're completing and different requirements that their organization asks of them, and they also are in the support raising phase of going. And so if that's something you might be interested in, we can give you more information on how you can partner financially with Bobby and Sarah, but also how you can be just updated regularly to pray on their behalf as they're preparing their family to kind of uproot and relocate way across the world. So just be thinking of them, praying for them. Bobby's currently still working here as a pilot in a Central Wisconsin airport, and they will be making a lot of transitions over this next year. So when you see them, when they're healthy and back with us, definitely go and introduce yourselves and ask more about how God's been leading them and where they're headed on the mission field. So children, you can be dismissed for Children's Church.
Good morning. It's good to be together, amen. Man, I woke up this morning, I felt good, and then we were worshiping, and then I felt really good. So my name is Aaron Keller. I'm the pastor of youth and family ministry here at Wausau Alliance Church, and it's my privilege just to be sharing on our second and final week of Missions Conference. I hope these past 2 weeks have been helpful for you and encouraging. It's a time we set aside really just to focus on missions as a church, because, really, that's what we're here for, right? To make disciples of Jesus Christ, to make disciples of all the nations, and it's been encouraging for me. I would just encourage you to have soft hearts. We had Bobby speak with the youth group this past Wednesday, and just to hear his story and how he said he was never going to do full-time missions work, and now he's doing it, was just a testimony to his humility, but also God's work in his life. And who knows where God might be calling each of us. Maybe it's not full-time missions, but where in Wausau, where in Burnhamwood, where in the surrounding areas might God be calling us. And so we're going to continue on that theme, talking through missions. I've titled today's talk, What's Stopping You? And that comes from a question that I've been asked by a number of my bosses. I don't think Greg's ever asked me. He should. But what's stopping you? He might have. I don't know. But it's a question that I get asked. It's that meeting, I don't know if you've ever had a meeting with a boss where they're asking about like your hopes and your dreams and your futures, if anybody's had that meeting. It was that meeting where they're like, what do you want to do, you know, in life, in the company? And I always give these like big grand ideas, like I want to write a book, I want to do this, I want to organize this. And then they ask the question, well, what's stopping you? And I hate that question. It makes me want to go like, what's stopping me from, you know, like jumping on you? I don't do that. But because... Because it highlights that there's an inconsistency in what I say I want to do, but then in what I'm actually doing. It's a really good question, and that's why I hate it. And so I want to ask that question this morning, what's stopping you? But I want to ask that in regards to what Pastor Greg talked about last week. And so kind of following on that theme of obedience, really the call to make disciples is obedience for all of us. It's a command, and at some point we have to treat it that way. And if we say we want to make disciples here at Wausau Alliance Church, but we're not doing it, we have to ask the question, what's stopping you? And so I want to look at Scripture. I think there's some things that Scripture shows us that lies underneath our disobedience, the ways in which we're not following God the way we should be. And now, obviously sin is a part of that, but I think there's some things going on at the heart level that lead to disobedience. So if you have your Bibles, open up to Jonah. Chapter 1. We'll start in chapter 1, but we're not going to obviously go through every part of Jonah in great detail. But if you're thinking of a passage in Scripture that talks about somebody who doesn't follow God's command to go share a message, I mean, Jonah's got to come up number one in your mind. Jonah chapter 1, because I think what we see in Jonah, we're going to kind of treat it in two sections, Jonah 1 and 2, and then Jonah 3 and 4. There's kind of two different parallel passages that expose what's going on in Jonah's heart. So if you don't know anything about Jonah, he's obviously in the time of the Old Testament. He was in the northern kingdom of Israel, working as a prophet for the Lord. And he's often called the reluctant prophet. And that comes from right away in Jonah chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord comes to Jonah, the son of Amittai, saying, arise, go to Nineveh, that great city, and call out against it, for their evil has come up before me. But Jonah rose to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. So God says, go, I want you to share this message with the Ninevites. This would have been people who didn't follow God. In fact, Nineveh was the capital of Assyria, which in a couple decades would take over the kingdom that Jonah was a part of, the northern kingdom of Israel. And God says, I want you to talk to them and tell them about their great evil and that I'm going to judge them. And Jonah says, that's a great idea, but no. And he leaves. He gets on a boat to go away from the presence of the Lord. And the story of Jonah has really been, in some ways, it's been abused by by kids' stories. So if you've ever read Jonah in a kid's story, we miss so much of what's going on in Jonah. We have a couple different kids' Bibles at our house, and we have one that I read through, and it's probably not the best, but I fill in the important details that I think are missing. But I read with my son, and it skips so much of Jonah. Because right away in Jonah, what we see is there's kind of a mystery. So God says, go and speak to the Ninevites, and Jonah leaves, but we don't know why. In a lot of kids' stories, they skip one chapter in Jonah, they skip chapter 4. And chapter 4, which we'll get to today, is kind of the big reveal of why Jonah is doing this. We also, in kids' stories, we tend to focus on the fish because, I mean, a fish swallows a person. It's pretty cool, and I understand that, but Jonah's really not about the fish at all. And a lot of the stories that make it sound like God is really mean, you know, because Jonah doesn't listen to him, and so God sends a storm, and then Jonah gets thrown overboard, and then God's like, and I'm going to make a fish eat you, right? Because you didn't listen to me. And the message is like, well, listen to God, or you'll get eaten by a fish. So that's it today. but it's really not about that. In fact, my son and I argue. I don't know why I even argue this. The title of the story in his Bible is called Jonah and the Big Fish, but he thinks it's called Jonah and the Big Day. And so I just say Jonah and the Big Fish because I want to argue with him. And I go, Jonah and the Big Fish. He goes, Jonah and the Big Day. But I think that's actually probably more accurate because it's really not about the fish. And in fact, what we see about the fish in Jonah 2, chapter 6, I'm just filling in some details before we dive into the book, so to speak. Jonah 2, verse 6, we see that the fish, thank you, the fish actually The fish actually is God's grace saving Jonah. Jonah's talking about going down to land whose bars closed upon me forever. In Jonah chapter 2, it's a prayer that Jonah offers while he's in the belly of the fish. And he says, yet you brought me up my life from the pit. That's Jonah saying that this fish literally saved me. You saved me when I was drowning. And so the fish was actually God's grace and mercy. But that's for free today. But what I want to focus on is, so Jonah gets on a boat. He goes to Joppa, and he's going on a ship going away to Tarshish, which, as far as we know, is the furthest place away from Nineveh, at least that he knew of at the time. That was as far away as he could get from where God wanted him to go. And so he's on this boat, and it doesn't work out well. God sends a storm, a mighty tempest, and it threatens to break the ship up. The captain, the sailors, they're panicking. They're trying to figure out, okay, whose fault is this? Which God is responsible for this? And so they cast lots, and finally it says in verse 7, it falls upon Jonah. And so now they know that Jonah is the problem. And right here, we're going to see a kind of a comparison between Jonah and the sailors. And this comparison is going to show us what's going on inside Jonah's heart that leads to his disobedience. And conversely, it's going to show what's going on inside of the sailors. And so Jonah has a couple, later in chapter 3, there's also a comparison between Jonah and the Ninevites. But I think this comparison here is a lot more telling. And so they come to Jonah in verse 8, and they say, tell us on whose account this evil has come upon us. What is your occupation? Where do you come from? And what is your country? And of what people you are? And in verse 9, I'm actually going to put this up on the screen because I think this is really neat, and it shows us what's going on in Jonah's heart. Jonah says this. He said, I am a Hebrew, and I fear the Lord. And he says, the God of heaven who made the sea and the dry land. And then the men were exceedingly afraid and said to him, what is this that you have done? For the men knew that he was fleeing from the presence of the Lord because he had told them. What do you notice between Jonah and the men that he's talking to, these sailors? So Jonah is a Hebrew, a guy who worships the God of Israel, the true God. And these are people who would not have worshipped that God. But what do you know, but what do you see contrasted between Jonah and those people? The first thing, and the main thing I see is that Jonah, he almost seems to have this spiritual pride, and he says, I'm a Hebrew, I fear the Lord, right? He says, I fear the right God, right? I got it all figured out. But what is the one thing that Jonah doesn't seem to have that the sailors have? Do you see it? He says, I fear the Lord, but what doesn't he have? Fear, right? There's no fear in Jonah. And he tells that to the men, and I love what they do. They don't say anything about fearing the Lord, but they show it, don't they? It says the men were exceedingly afraid, and they said to him, what have you done? Like, they're like, we wouldn't have dared to do this. And Jonah, the person who says he fears the Lord, he seemed to have no problem with all of this. And later in verse 16, it says, then the men feared the Lord exceedingly, and they offered a sacrifice to the Lord and made vows. And so we see right away in Jonah that a fear of the Lord leads to obedience, but on the same hand, a lack of the fear of the Lord leads to disobedience. And I think the thing that we see under a lot of our disobedience, and maybe even under our disobedience and following the call to make disciples of Jesus Christ, wherever we're at, to live on mission, is a lack of the fear of the Lord. It's the idea that we don't fear God the way we should. And we talk about fearing God, and we worship God, and we sing songs to him. But is there really any fear underneath that? Do we truly fear God? And I think that's the first thing that we see in Jonah. If we're going to grow in our obedience, we need to grow in our fear of the Lord. But you might be saying, yeah, I get that. I get the fear of the Lord. I know we should fear the Lord. But, I mean, that's a little bit Old Testament, right? And maybe you wouldn't say that, but I think sometimes we act this way. Like, fear of the Lord's more Old Testament with the sacrifices and splitting of the Red Sea. But now Jesus has come. And we don't really need to fear Jesus, right? It's not the same. You know, Jesus is like, he calls the disciples friends. Jesus is like my bro, you know? He's like my, no, you wouldn't say that, hopefully. But I think sometimes we treat Jesus that way, right? We're like, Jesus, you know, he came down and he died on the cross. And now there's no condemnation, so there's no fear. But I want to look at a passage in Mark chapter 3. So turn in your Bibles to Mark chapter 3. Just to carry this idea of the fear of the Lord into the New Testament. This is something that Pastor Greg shared with us this week, and I thought it was really good. I didn't know if I wanted to share it because I didn't want him to get a big head, but it fit too well. So Mark chapter 3, Mark chapter 4, I'll start in verse 35, and I'll put some of it up on the screen. But Mark chapter 4, verse 35, this is the story where Jesus goes out with his disciples, and they're going across the lake, and as they get a little ways into the lake, it says, a great windstorm arose, and the waves were breaking into the boat so that the boat was already filling. But Jesus was at the stern asleep on the cushion, which is funny because Jonah in his story was also asleep. And they woke him and they said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" So the disciples, they're afraid. I don't know how Jesus sleeps through this, but I think I could too. So maybe he's a heavy sleeper. And he awoke and he rebuked the wind and he said to the sea, "Peace, be still." And the wind ceased and there was a great calm. And then Jesus says this to them, and I think this is very telling and very interesting. Jesus says, "Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith?" And so a lot of times we stop there and we say, see, Jesus says, "Why are you so afraid? Have you no faith?" We're not supposed to be afraid. But then what's the next line? "And they were filled with great fear and said to one another, 'Who is this that even the wind and the sea obey him?'" I love that. Jesus says, "Why are you afraid?" And then it says, "And they were filled with great fear." What is that? Well, what Jesus is doing is he's saying, why are you so afraid of all the things around you? He's taking their fear. He's saying, that's not the kind of fear that should be in your life, this horizontal fear. And he's redirecting it towards himself. He's saying the fear you should have is a vertical fear, a fear towards me. And that will prevent you from fearing all the things around us. And I think so often we get caught up in the fears of this world, right? The fears of things in this life. And those keep us from making disciples, right? From doing the things that we should be doing. The one thing maybe that we should be doing most of all, making disciples. And I don't know what that looks like. Maybe that's going full time into missions work, but maybe that's somewhere in your local context. And this Sunday, we want to have a little bit more of a local focus today, but maybe that's in Wausau, in Burnhamwood, in the surrounding areas, at your work, at your home, wherever it is. How are you making disciples? So often, I think fears distract us from that and keep us from that, whatever it may be. And what Jesus did is he didn't just say, get rid of all fear. No, he said, your fear should be directed towards me, right? This fear of the Lord. And that's why we get to Philippians 2. 12 through 13, I love that David read 1 through 11. It was great. In Philippians 2, 12 through 13, it says this, "Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, so now, not only as in my presence, but much more in my absence, work out your salvation with fear and trembling." Why? "For it is God who works in you, both to will and to work for his good pleasure." We are to work out our salvation with fear and trembling. Why? Because it's God. It's God who's working in us. And this God is big and he's sovereign and he's powerful. Now, I'm not saying this fear. What is the fear of the Lord? It's not the sense of we're running around afraid that God's going to smite us, right? He could, but that's not the fear we're talking about. The Bible says perfect love casts out fear. That's the fear that has to do with judgment. If you have trusted in Jesus Christ, we're not afraid of condemnation. There's no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Amen? Right? So what is this fear? The best way I can describe it, I think awe is a good word. Awe is a good word. A lot of times people say awe. But the best way I can describe it is an illustration. When I go out west to visit my family, I get to see the mountains because they're in Montana. Like the real mountains. Kind of like Rib Mountain, but just a little bigger. Rib Mountain is a real mountain too. But you get to, that joke just never gets old. It's always there. But you get to Montana and you see these giant mountains and they kind of come up out of nowhere. And when you see these mountains, you can't help but feeling a sense of awe and like respect and wonder and maybe fear because they're so big. Like every skyscraper and thing we've created, it pales in comparison to these mountains. And even more so, when you start getting closer to the mountains and you start driving up through the mountains, you start to feel that awe a lot more. And so it changes how you behave, right, in your conduct. So while I might, on a back road in Wisconsin, I might go a little over the speed limit, and I don't usually do that. I'm not encouraging that. But you might go a little faster. Like, there's just, what's the fear? It's all flat and straight. It's not that bad. But when you get up into the mountains, you don't go much over the speed limits, right? And you're on the edge, and you're like when I drive through the mountains, I'm like this, and I'm like looking over. Like, it changes because there's a sense in which it's so much beyond you, right? And that there's a sense in which God is too, and there's that quote from C.S. Lewis, his Narnia stories, right? When they talk about Aslan, and they say, well, is he safe? And they say, no, he's not safe, but he's good. That's the same with our God. He's not safe. He's big. He's powerful. And if we regain an awareness of the fear of the Lord and his mighty, like how mighty and big and powerful he is, that'll lead to mission. That'll lead to us living on mission. And I would submit to you this morning that one of the reasons maybe that we don't make disciples the way we should is because we've let the fears of this world trump the fear of the Lord. I want to read a quote from Jared Wilson. He's an author and works at a seminary, and it's a little long, but I think it's really good just to capture this idea of what the fear of the Lord looks like. It's long, but I think he writes in a fun enough way that it also goes pretty fast. He says, as it pertains to having the living God draw near to us, fear and trembling assume it is truly God and the glorious Christ we have encountered and not some pitiful caricature. The God of the prosperity gospelist is a pathetic doormat, a genie. The God of the cutesy coffee mugs and Joel Osteen tweets is a milquetoast doofus like the guys in the Jane Austen novels you hope the girls don't end up with, holding their hats limply in hand and minding their manners to follow your lead like a butler or the doormat he stands on. The God of the American dream is Santa Claus. The God of the open theist is not sovereignly omniscient, declaring the end from the beginning, but just a really good guesser, playing the odds. The God of our therapeutic culture is ourselves. We are the forgivers of ourselves, navel-haloed morons with baggage, but not sin. None of these pathetic gods could provoke fear and trembling, but the God of the scriptures is a consuming fire. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. He stirs up the oceans with the tip of his finger, and they sizzle, rolling clouds of steam into the sky. He shoots lightning from his fist. This is the God who leads his children by a pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. This is the God who makes war and sends plagues and sits enthroned in majesty and glory in the heavens, doing what he pleases. This is the God who incarnate in the flesh turned tables over in the temple like he owned the place. This Lord God Jesus Christ was pushed to the edge of a cliff and declared, this is not happening today, and walked right back through the crowd like a boss. I love that. This Lord says, nobody takes my life. I give it willingly, as if to say, you couldn't kill me unless I let you. This Lord calms the storms, casts out demons, binds and looses, and has authority to grant us the same. And then I love this last part. The devil is this God's lapdog, and it is this God who has summoned us, apprehended us, saved us. It is this God who has come humbly, meek, lowly, pouring out his blood in infinite conquest to set the captives free, cancel the record of debt against us, conquer sin and Satan, and swallow up death forever. Amen? I love that quote. I know, I love that. And I mean, it's not only that this is the God that we worship, but what Philippians 2 says, this is the God who is working in us this morning, right? This is the God who, when we've trusted him, he comes and lives inside of us and is changing us. He's a powerful God. And so whatever you're facing this morning, God's bigger than that, amen? And so this fear of God, it's not this fear and trembling. There is a sense of awe. There is a sense of being afraid, but there's a sense that this is encouraging and this is good news. And I believe if we truly believe that, if we truly believe God is who he says he is, it would change the way we live on mission. But there's one more thing in the book of Jonah. One more thing. So turn back to Jonah. There's one more thing that I think is highlighted in the heart of Jonah that Jonah is missing. And consequently, why he doesn't live on mission the way he's supposed to. And something that I think leads to us not living on mission as well. So starting in Jonah chapter 3, I'm just going to kind of skip through that passage a little bit, but summarize. So Jonah, the word of the Lord comes to Jonah a second time, go to Nineveh. He does that. He preaches like the world's shortest message, yet 40 days and Nineveh shall be overthrown. And the most amazing thing happens. These people who don't know God, don't follow God, they're one of the most powerful empires at the time. Maybe in a sense they would feel like they don't need God, but they hear this message about their sin and God's wrath. And the people of Nineveh believed God, it says in verse 5. They called out for a fast and put on sackcloth from the greatest of them to the least of them. And it says, the word reached the king of Nineveh, so one of the most powerful people at the time, and he arose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth and in ashes, and he issued a proclamation published through Nineveh. So the king comes, he gets up, and what does he do? He offers a proclamation. He says this, by the decree of the king and his nobles, let neither man nor beast, herd nor flock, taste anything. Let them not feed or drink water, but let man and beast be covered with sackcloth. For some reason, he thought the animals maybe needed to repent too. And let them call out mightily to God. So there's this whole scale repentance. And it says, when God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil way, God relented to the disaster that he had said he would do to them, and he did not do it. So God saves these people. When they turn to him, when they repent, God shows them mercy. And we get to chapter 4, and this is Jonah's response, and this is very telling of Jonah's heart. It says this in 4 verse 1, but it displeased Jonah exceedingly, and he was angry. And in verse 2, and he prayed to the Lord, and he said, O Lord, is this not what I said when I was yet in my country? That is why I made haste to flee to Tarshish, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. Therefore, now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, do you do well to be angry? So we see Jonah is, we see the reason why he ran in the first place is that he knew that God was loving and gracious and he would forgive these people. Isn't that crazy? Jonah knew this about God. He actually, in fact, he experienced that from God. And yet, when he sees God's love shown to other people, he gets so angry. He says he's angry enough to die. And he goes outside the city. We see the rest of the story. He goes out and he sits outside the city watching, almost hoping that maybe God is still going to destroy the city, right? Just like, I mean, he just sits there waiting. And God creates a plant, just to kind of summarize the last part of the story. God creates a plant to kind of give him some shade and some comfort. And Jonah, he just falls in love with this plant. He's like, this plant is great. I'm comfortable. And then God ends up killing the plant. And Jonah gets so mad again, so dramatic. He says, I'm angry enough that I could die. And in verse 9, God said to Jonah, do you do well to be angry for the plant? And he said, yes, I do well to be angry, angry enough to die. And the Lord said, you pity the plant for which you did not labor, nor did you make it grow, which came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not pity Nineveh and that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons who do not know their right hand from their left and also much cattle? That is to say, God's like, if not care about the people, care about the cattle, at the very least, Jonah. And this last part in Jonah, it sticks out to me because now we see Jonah's heart contrasted with God's heart. And we see what Jonah's missing is he's missing love for other people. He's missing the forgiveness of sins. And he's got to a place, and this is scary to me, he's got to a place where he cares more about the things that give him comfort and the things that make him comfortable than the people who God loves and made in his own image. And the scary thing is Jonah knows that. He knows all about God's love. He's experienced it, right? He says, I know that you're a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and relenting from disaster. And that makes him mad. He knows all of that about God's love, and yet he has no love for other people. So the question we have to ask is, how is it that Jonah can miss God's love so much when he knows so much about it? Turn with me real quick, and this is where we're going to close. Turn with me to Luke chapter 7. I'll just jump down to the last part. So Luke chapter 7 will be in verse 48, 49. I'll pull some of this up on the screen as well, just to so you can see this. Luke chapter 7, we're going to read starting kind of in 36. I'll summarize a little bit, but we'll jump down to the end. So if you don't know the story, Jesus is hanging out with some of the Pharisees, the religious people of the day, and he's hanging out with them, he's sitting, and a woman comes in, kind of a, you know, known sinner of the town, and she comes in, and she brings some ointment, and she wets Jesus' feet with her tears, and she wipes his feet. You know, that would have been something that a servant would do, right? We see that with the disciples when they're arguing over who should wash feet, and Jesus washes their feet, right? This, the idea of washing feet back then was something that somebody, a servant would do for somebody who was of a higher status. And this woman comes in and she wipes Jesus' feet with her tears and then she anoints his feet. And the Pharisees, when they see this, instead of being like, wow, that was awesome, they go, how dare this woman do this to Jesus? And if Jesus knew what this woman was like. And so Jesus talks to the Pharisees a little bit. He gives them a story, but then he concludes this way. And I want to pull this up on the screen. Luke 7, verses 47, 48. He says, therefore I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. And he says this right here, but he who is forgiven little loves little. And he said to her, your sins are forgiven. That line right there, but he who is forgiven little loves little. I think this illustrates what Jonah was missing and maybe what we miss as well. What is Jesus saying? Is he saying that the Pharisees didn't have a lot of sin and that only this woman had a lot of sin? No, that's not what he's saying. What he's saying is that this woman recognizes that she has sin, and the Pharisees don't. The people in the room don't. And so they don't think they need God's forgiveness, right? But he said this woman realized that she needed God's forgiveness, and so she turned to Jesus. And when she experienced the forgiveness of sins, she loved much. It produced love in her. When we experience God's grace and his love, we'll love people. The Bible says we love because he first loved us. And so not only was Jonah missing the fear of God, but he was also missing God's love. He's missing God's love. He got to a point, and when you read this whole book of Jonah, you can see he got to a point where he felt like he just, you know, maybe didn't need God's love that much. Like, he's pretty good. He always looks at his identity and the things he's doing. And my fear is that maybe we've gotten into the same boat, in a sense. We start checking all the boxes. We start off trusting in Jesus with this awareness of our sin and our great need for God's love. But then once we've experienced, we kind of get a little further down the road and we're reading our Bibles a little more, praying, going to church, checking boxes. And all of a sudden we get to a point and we say, maybe I don't need God's love as much. Maybe I can kind of do this on my own strength and I don't need God's grace. And we get to that point and all of a sudden we've forgotten that we are forgiven for our sins and this great message we have. And then we're just not loving people the way we should because we're not experiencing God's love. And so for us, in order for us to obey God the way that we should and to grow in our obedience, we have to grow in the fear of the Lord, but we also have to grow in our awareness of God's forgiveness for our sins and the forgiveness of God. We need to keep preaching the gospel to ourselves daily, reminding ourselves of what we've been forgiving, letting the smallest sin affect us in the biggest way. And so we need to spend times reflecting and meditating on the gospel, realizing that we never outgrow the gospel. Because when we start getting to the point where we think that we've got it all figured out, we start putting God into a box and we think that we don't need his forgiveness or his grace anymore. That's the point where we stop making disciples. And so my encouragement this morning is just to look at your hearts, right? For all of us, just to look at our hearts and say, am I truly savoring and worshiping God for how big he is and how great he is? But am I also worshiping him and savoring him and truly loving him for how much he's loved me and forgiven me for my sins? We're gonna close this morning. We're gonna do something a little different. We're gonna bring up just a few people. I've asked a few people to come share, and I'll call them up in a second, just to share about how they've seen God working just locally in Wausau. We wanted to, because we can talk about being obedient to the call to make disciples, but I really wanted to put some flesh on the bones, so to speak. And what does this look like when we are obedient in our local context? So I want to bring a few people up here just to share ways that they've seen God working as they've been faithful to make disciples. So I'm actually going to have Sandy Schmidt come up here, Beth Anderson, if Beth Anderson's up here, and then and Brad Leader come up here. So I don't know if I see Beth. Oh, there's Beth. Hi, Beth. I was like, oh, we got 2 out of 3. That's pretty good. That's how I work on student ministry trips, too. So if we bring back 2 out of 3 students, it's a win. I don't know if you know these people, but they're all people in different ways who have just been faithful to follow Jesus and to live on mission and have stories of God's working. And so we wanted just to show what it looks like to live on mission, but also we want to be a church that celebrates stories and testimonies of God's working. And so I'm just going to give them each like 2-ish minutes just to share, one, how they've seen God working and what motivated them to live on mission. So here you go, Sandy. Thank you.
Yeah, we have definitely seen God working in a number of areas. Our probably most recently just have seen him working within our neighborhood. We do just a lot of things together as a neighborhood, or we try to encourage that. So we'll have, you know, the kids trick-or-treat together. We'll do bonfires at our house, Super Bowl at our house. This winter we built an ice rink together as a neighborhood just to try to get people together more so that when relationships are built, then we do have opportunity to speak into people's lives. And recently we had just some friends go through a marriage crisis, and it was very, very close to divorce. And through just this past year and a half of a Bible study, prayer, accountability, some counseling, and also just an event we ended up inviting them to, God ended up using that event to basically really turn their hearts, and they ended up recommitting to one another. So that was a huge praise. Yeah. And the cool thing was that they ended up identifying that God was the one that really brought them to that place. So that was really neat to see. Our neighborhood consists of Mormons and Catholics and atheists and Christians, so just a wide variety of belief systems, but it was really cool to see them attribute that to God. I wanted to share an encouragement as well. We've done a lot of foster care ministry since 2014 and gotten to know a lot of people from hard places, and something neat that I was just reflecting on in the past that God did is still an encouragement to me and is part of why I feel motivated to continue on. Is we had met a lady who was struggling with addiction. She had been an addict for over a decade. And she ended up going to prison. And for a number of years, we exchanged letters and talked a lot of theology and a lot of God's grace through those letters. And She ended up getting baptized 4 years ago, and the last 4 years she has been clean, sober, and has held down a full-time job and now has a family. So just an encouragement to those of you that are walking with people from just hard places, and that God can still work, and so to keep pressing on.
Thanks, Amy.
I'm very humbled to be up here because I know many of you just live so intentionally and you're all missional. The people I know in this church live this way, but I'll just share some of what it looks like to be faithful and obedient in my life. It can mean just getting up 30 minutes earlier to abide in the Holy Spirit and much earlier than I want to wake up to really ask the Holy Spirit. You know, He probably has a different agenda for my day than I do, and just being open to what might be happening that day. It can look like respite care to kids with special needs and networking just to the therapy community, because they are definitely watching the church and how they're interacting with special needs families. It's just sometimes just using those everyday moments and using what you have, hospitality. We have an ice rink as well behind our house, and there have been so many hockey games and children welcomed in and out and families. It's really been a source of ministry for us. It's been cool. Sometimes faithfulness just looks like sitting and having tea for hours with a refugee family, and just, you know, it kind of takes your whole day sometimes, but building bridges, building relationships, and entertaining their children while they go to appointments, you know, that's been another way that sometimes faithfulness and obedience will stop your life, or those teenage silver platter moments, as our study calls them, just where you sense that you need to stop life and have a very important conversation with your teenagers or with the teenagers that are in your home, you know, and being open to seeing where the Holy Spirit's working around you. I don't do this well all the time, but I that's how I try to live. Sometimes it's inviting my youth group girls with me to serve at the King's Table, which is a ministry here at our church, and just having more time with them, enjoying serving with them. And there's just a lot of moments using those everyday moments. Sometimes it's just making dinner without complaining, right? And making dinner for other people who lost loved ones, or, you know, it takes time. It takes time to serve the Lord. I didn't say I love making dinner. and then the biggest way I've leaned into the Lord this year is in prayer with other people, setting up times to pray with other people, more corporate prayer. It's been so sweet to see, first of all, God absolutely answers specific requests constantly, and my faith and confidence has grown so much, and it just compels me. Pastor Aaron asked what our motivation for all of this is, and obviously the love of Christ compels us. I owe Him my life. Like, how could I not live this way? I heard a story of a grandma whose kids were taking her to the movie theater, and they said, "Grandma, are you so excited to go to the movies?" And she said, "Heavens, no! What if Jesus comes back and finds me watching a movie in the theater? When Jesus comes back, I want to be serving the Lord. I want to be helping people. I want to be serving God with my life every moment." And that seems impossible, but it's such a good way to live. And as Catherine Graber also said, when you start ministering to people, it's really addicting, and you really just, it's so fulfilling, and it gives you so much joy. That's just how you want to live, you know?
Thanks, Beth.
So, wrote a few things here, but this is just how it kind of looks like in my life. I'll just give you a little background. My career is I'm a tattoo artist. I've been doing that for 22 years, so I get to see a lot of different types of people all the time, and from, you know, really straight-laced people to drug-addicted type people, so it's pretty cool. So I get a chance to really share with them. But how witnessing to somebody, you know, I guess I would say it starts, like, right here in your heart, you know. It's your relationship. I mean, that's one thing that I look at. I'll get up and make sure, you know, every day, you know, I seek the Lord, and a lot of times it's like you just want to be on that page. I use the words where Jesus says, you know, I can only do what I see the Father doing. So that's kind of like a prayer that I pray, so it's not just me kicking the tires all the time and forcing myself or forcing the witness, you know, like, do you know Jesus? Because you could run around and do that to everybody, and it just kind of turns into you, you know, forcing that. And I just want to know where the Holy Spirit's working. And there's days where you don't see anything happen. There might even be months where you go, but then all of a sudden it's like, it's day after day after day. It almost gets overwhelming, and I think the Lord knows that. But your best witness is your walk, how you talk, how you act, how you present yourself. You know, I mean, if you're if you're acting like a sinner and then you're telling somebody they need to turn and repent from their sins, you know, people aren't stupid, especially in the world. They have a hard time with, at least from what I'm gathering, they have a hard time with organized religion because of hypocrisy and things. That's what they see. So, I mean, if you're walking, not walking it out, and you're trying to share Christ with somebody, it's going to be a real tough sell, you know. But if you're walking it out, it's not even a sell. I mean, I've just been talking before. There was a young man, I'll give you a story. I was just talking about Jesus and walking in the Holy Spirit. I wasn't even witnessing to him. I'm just telling him, like, because I was having a really good day, you know. And I'm just saying, like, hey, this is really awesome. It's really great walking in the Holy Spirit. And he's sitting over there, and he's just doing one of these things. He's just... couldn't even look at me, and I'm like, oh, am I offending you? You know what I mean? I didn't say that to him, but I started to feel like, well, maybe I'm preaching at him or something. And he's like, dude, every time you say walking in the Holy Spirit, I just want to break down. And I go, we'll do it. And he broke down. He was a Christian, you know, at one time, and he just repented right there. I mean, it was sloppy. I mean, this is a young guy. I mean, 25 years old, big dude. And, I mean, it was like he's hugging me, snot and everything. And I'm like, ah, this is great. But, you know, that's the thing is, like, it doesn't become a job when you have Christ moving in your life, when you're walking this thing out. So, you know, I guess if you're going to really want to save people, you don't even have to try if your life is walking with the Lord. But... and it's just really coming into an understanding, you know, that Jesus is real and the reality of Jesus, that they're not just stories. You know, I've met people that, you know, they'll go to church, they're doing it just in case, you know, in case this is real, in case, you know, Jesus is real, I'll go to church, I'll you know, say the prayers, I'll go through the motions, you know, and they think that that's salvation, and there's a lot more to it than that, and I only got like 2 minutes. I'm going over, but that's okay. But the number one thing is, if you're going to approach somebody about Christ and want to share with them, is having godly love. I mean, just the scripture where it says, you know, I can speak with tongues of angels and, you know, do all these miraculous things, but have not love, I'm a resounding gong. You know, so it's like you're doing it out of your own. If you're not really genuinely caring that person's salvation, whether they go to heaven or hell, you know, if that's not in your heart, you know, I mean, you're just kind of doing it out of your own thing. So, and then you can share with them what they can be, you know, in Christ. And knowing who you are in Christ is going to help do that too. So, but other than that, I just kind of kick the tires with people when we're talking. I'll just be like, hey, you know, what do you think about God? You know, or do you believe in that? Or, you know, just to, you know, we talk about all kinds of stuff, but I try to get this to be one of the topics we talk about, and this is where I start to see if it's the Holy Spirit drawing them, or if it's just me. Or we just have a nice conversation, or, you know, all of a sudden they just start blowing up. So, and also, if you are feeling that love, and you are walking this thing out, and I'm glad that you talked about fear, you know, because we're not just in a fight between the devil and you. I mean, you have your flesh nature to deal with as well that's going to try to work against you, and it's going to give you this fear, like, you know, maybe you shouldn't go and say that. What if you look stupid? Or man, I don't know if I try to tell them about, or even pray for them or whatever. Can I share one of the stories that we got?
Yeah, can you do 2 minutes?
Two more minutes, sure.
That's good, we'll make it.
Anyway, yeah. I just, you know, after I started realizing this, the one question was always, you know, I would read in the Bible about where you can lay hands on people and they'll recover, you know, and for my whole life, I was just like, I don't see that. So, I mean, I've had my struggles in the past as well with this up and down. And when I started to just, there's a lot more to it than this, but when I started to live like that, I remember the first time I laid my hands on a friend of mine. She had scoliosis of the spine. That day she had a urinary tract infection, and I just, it's one of those, just ran about by her, you know, and I said, hey, I should pray for you. She says, like, yeah, yeah. So, you know, I laid my hand on her, and of course I asked. I wasn't just groping her or anything, but just laid my hand on her back, and she's a good friend of mine, and we started to pray, and she said, you know, I started to feel really warm there. Long story short, she goes, it's gone. And she goes, now I feel that rising up into my back. And I'm like, well, because I knew she had scoliosis, you know. And I'm like, well, we should just keep praying. She's like, yeah. So we just kept praying, you know, and just asking God, you know, just take this and heal this. And this is a girl that if I tried to crack her back, if you got one pop, you know, that was a good thing. She stood straight up and went like this, and it was just like a zipper, just right up. She went the other way, just right up. She had one leg that was an inch and a half shorter than the other one, and it just popped right out. And she's been, that's been 3 years ago or something like that. So, yeah, so God, instantly, yeah, praise the Lord for that. And that's something that's, you know, stories like that, I got lots of them. And I might know, it isn't me, it's just, it can be anyone walking this thing out correctly, you know, getting right with the Lord and keeping him number one in your life. So
awesome.
Here you go.
Thanks, Brad. Yeah,
just one third.
2 minutes on the dot. thank you. Thank you guys for sharing, Beth and Sandy. We just wanted to highlight that God is working around the world, but he's working here in Wausau. He's working in Burnham Wood. And if we live with a fear of the Lord and with an awareness of his forgiveness and love, we'll be able to see him working, you know, in each of us. And so I'm going to close with prayer, and we'll have the ushers come up to take offering. Father, thank you so much for this morning. Thank you for just your heart, God, your heart that didn't wait for us to run to you. You came to us. You sent Jesus down to do for us what we could never do for ourselves. And so I just pray that reality, God, the reality of the God who created the universe wanting a relationship with us and providing that through Jesus Christ, that would spur us on towards mission. I thank you for the testimonies, God, of the ways you're working. I know there's so many more ways that you're working, God, and I just pray that we'd be a church that shares those stories and celebrates those stories and celebrates people coming to know Jesus Christ, transferring from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light. And so I just pray for Wausau, for the surrounding area, and for to the ends of the earth, God, we pray that we would see the gospel lifted up, the name of Jesus lifted up. We pray these things in your son's name. And all God's people said, amen.
I think I'll remember that quote for a while. When we talk about the best thing that we can do when sharing Christ is to be walking with him. Let our talk match our walk, right? But the great thing about that is ultimately God did that first. Now, many times we can look at other denominations and they had a day of remembrance called Ash Wednesday, where they look back and they prepare their hearts for what's coming, which Easter is coming. But the great thing about it for us as well is we don't just have Ash Wednesday, but we have communion. We have the Lord's Supper. A greater time to remember what the Lord has done. One of my favorite passages in Scripture is Isaiah 53. A prophecy of the Lord's coming in Isaiah 53, of what Jesus was ultimately going to do. And this is what it says. This is, keep in mind, hundreds of years before Christ would even come to the cross. For he grew up before him like a young plant and like a root out of the dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him and no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and as one from men hide their faces. And he was despised and we esteemed him not. Hear of the cross of Jesus. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. This is the miraculous promise of God that's been fulfilled in Jesus. A covenant, a promise of God's faithfulness. So that's what communion, a part of communion is to look back and remember of what Christ has done for us. Now, you don't have to be a member here at Wausau Alliance Church to partake of this, but you do have to be a member of the family of God. You have to have trusted in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior to partake of this. And I want to encourage you this morning, if you are walking with Christ, if you are a follower of Jesus, I encourage you, 1 Corinthians 11 encourages us to prepare our hearts. I don't know what your week has done, but I'm sure your week was similar in this with me. I've sinned. And so this is a great opportunity that as we hand out the communion bread and as we hand out the juice, to prepare your hearts before the Lord, knowing that he is faithful and just to forgive us of sins. If there is a brother or sister you are quarreling with and have not made, I encourage you to go to that person. Maybe make a phone call. Maybe leave the room and go make it right. Prepare your hearts. So I'd like the elders to come forward and to help us serve. But take some time as we get ready to hand this out just to prepare your own hearts before the Lord. Lord, we come before you knowing that if we came before you on our own merit, our own standing, our own good deeds, it pales in comparison to your righteousness. Are not our righteous deeds like filthy rags before you? But we thank you, Father, for your word, which declares of a God who drew near to us, of a God who came before us, going to a cross, dying, rising from the grave to pay life to those who are so undeserving. But we thank you for that love. We thank you for that grace. And so I've asked that you would bless this time of observing your death and your sacrifice, you giving your blood and your body on our behalf. We pray your blessings on this in Jesus' name. And when he had taken the bread, he had said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance with me." Finally, he said, "This is the cup, the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. Do this in remembrance with me." Please take and drink. Father, how beautiful it is to remember and recall the work of your Son on the cross, but also his rising from the grave. And then we anxiously await the day where we will be in complete restoration with you, freed from this body of sin, freed from the iniquities and the shortcomings, the pains, the toils, the anxieties, and to be with you. We look forward to that day, and we praise you and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand as we close in singing together.
Suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Were the whole earth echoing his eminence, his name would burst from sea and sky. Then from rivers to the mountain tops, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Let his praise arise, Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life, Christ be magnified in me. When every creature finds its inmost melody, and every human heart its native cry. Oh, in one enraptured hymn of praise, we'll sing Christ be magnified. Praise arise, Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life, Christ be magnified in me. stand strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice cause you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings, I hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, then I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your sufferings, then I'll join you when you rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified.
Magnified in our lives this week. God, help us to walk by your Spirit, to be led by you in the areas of our lives where you have given us access to people who need to know you. Jesus, lead us. I pray that you would go with us now. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm a prisoner no more.